My name is Shanaa Safler. I'm the President-elect of the Psychological Society of South Africa. Thank you once more for your patience and a very warm welcome to you as we connect virtually to open this 2021 PsySSA webinar series. And you probably have seen that we have titled it Troubling Psychology in Troubled Times. And we do so through what promises to be a very compelling and a very inspiring first webinar. And Prof. Ratele, we're not setting you up. First, a word about the series, though. The series was introduced to continue some of the conversations that would have otherwise have taken place at the PsySSA Annual Congress, but for obvious reasons, we are not able to host that this year. Importantly, we believe the series provides a platform to extend these engagements so that we go well beyond the disciplinary, the geographical and other kinds of boundaries that become so defined by the way in which in-person conferences tend to be organized. So this is how the webinar series came about. But I should add that in place of the Congress, PsySSA is hosting a number of events, very exciting events, I might add, in different formats directed at a range of needs and serving multiple audiences and multiple publics. You'll hear more about that through information that is shared in the chat. We're running a workshop series, but it's really the webinar series I want to say a little more about. It's hosted by the PsySSA Presidency. We hope that you will feel excited enough to join the remaining three after tonight's launch webinar. We are hosting four webinars in this series. They're all free, open to all, CPD accredited. And we do believe that this particular theme for this year amplifies and contributes to what is clearly one of the foci at the cutting or the leading edge of psychology at this particular moment. What we're planning to do in addition is to conclude with another flagship PsySSA event, which is the PsySSA Annual President's Lecture. The lecture is also going to be hosted in memory of the past PsySSA presidents, those who have passed, as a way of honoring their contributions, recognizing their contributions to the society, to the discipline, to the profession. So that's a little bit about the webinar series and associated events. And very quickly, I've been asked to share information with you by the PsySSA office about CPD and other matters. So I just want to say if you're interested in receiving CPD points for this event, please complete the evaluation form, which will be shared in the chat in the last 15 to 20 minutes of the event. As I said, more information on the series as well as the workshops will be shared during the webinar itself. We will avail the webinar recording through the PsySSA YouTube channel in due course. And we hope that you will engage with all these many very exciting sharings. With that, let me say again that we are thoroughly delighted to have so many of you join us for this first webinar of the series. We're very, very pleased about the collective interest and the impulse towards generative forms of unsettling psychology so that we continue doing what we have been doing for a while, which is to question psychology, to appraise it critically, and to act to influence the constitutive elements and the processes and the place and role of psychology in contemporary troubled times. So for very many reasons, really, this webinar series is a necessary and a timely one, certainly in the context of the current multiple and the interlocking crises that we are facing in this country, and I certainly don't have to name them, but also across the world. We also think that in these times, we need to be challenged, necessarily challenged, once more, to commit and to recommit to the kinds of work, the consciousness, the actions and the solidarities that support movement towards the kinds of changes that we wish to see. So that's a little bit about the webinar series. Turning now to this webinar itself, our first webinar, which I keep saying, because I want to underline that, it is the webinar that launches the series. I believe it's going to be a scene-setting webinar, and we're thoroughly excited about this session, which is going to be led by Professor Kopana Ratele. A little bit about the what Professor Ratele has promised us or teased us with, titled Freedom Looks Like This Here. Prof Ratele will share and expand on his thoughts on psychological freedom contained in his book. And the book is titled The World Looks Like This From Here, Thoughts on African Psychology. The webinar title is intriguing. The book is superb. Please, everyone, get yourself a copy if you don't have one already. Insert it into your reading lists, into your reading groups. Tell your students about it. Tell your friends about it. Students, share it with your friends. Review it, gift yeah. it. Just read it, I guess is what I'm saying. And no, I'm not. I don't work for the publisher, but it's University Press, if you want, okay. In case you're wondering.
All right.
So, yes, that's a little bit about the book. An introduction to Professor Ratele, my colleague, my accomplice and friend, is a professor at Stellenbosch University. As many of you know, he's a leading scholar on African psychology. His recent articles include one titled Four African Psychologies, A Decolonial African-Centered Psychology of Anti-Racism, Three Pathways for Enlarging Critical Psychology, African Psychology, and For Whom is a Decolonizing African Psychology. He has several books that he has published, and I know that are in the works. There is much more that I could say to introduce Professor Ratele, but that would make it a very long introduction. So I'll stop there. Professor Ratele will be joined by Professor Peace Kigua, who will serve as discussant. Professor Kigua is an associate professor in psychology at the University of the Witwatersrand. Her research interests include critical social psychology, affective politics of gender and sexuality, racism and racialization, and she's also the current chair of the Sexuality and Gender Division at PsySSA. Professor Kigua is herself nothing short of an excellent scholar activist herself. In fact, when I listen to her talks, almost always I don't want her to stop. Such is the experience of listening to her and absorbing from her insights and her astuteness. So really, I am thoroughly excited about this evening. I'm sure you are too. And so it's really a pleasure to open the PsySSA webinar series with this particular engagement. Professor Ratele, we look forward to your sharings on psychological freedom this evening. Professor Kigua, we look forward to your reflections. I hand over to you. Thank you so much.
Good evening, everybody. Hello, Peace.
Hi, Kopano.
Okay, you're here.
I just wanted
I'm here.
To check. We've been having a bit of a struggle there. Thank you. I guess I could. I should begin with my thanks to PsySSA, in particular the office and the presidency, in inviting me to open the series of seminars, of webinars, seminars online. My friend and colleague, Shana Safla, has told you they persuaded me that I should kick off the webinar with a sort of grounding, but also to offer some thoughts that I am working on, or at least expanding from the book that she mentioned. And the discussant, as you heard, is Professor Peace Kigua, who's, like Shona said, is someone who, as you will hear, is thoroughly enjoyable as a thinker, and playful, ecstatic in her thinking. And so I'm looking forward to this. I want to begin by asking Mohammed whether you will be so kind as to put up the presentation. The title of what I want to talk to you about is there. As Shanas has told you about it. And perhaps before I move on, and I see quite a number of people who are on the webinar. So welcome, thank you for making time to be with us for this hour and a half or so. And I will keep on asking Mohammed just to move forward. So can you move to the second slide, please? A few years ago, I was taking my son to school, as I usually do, in the morning. It was a Tuesday morning, because I came back and wrote it down, but also because I'd been thinking about a number of things related to the book. In the building to the elementary school, just on the stairs to his class, there are lots of signs. And one of the signs I saw that morning read, "Ideas, ideas, ideas." Many different ideas, share your ideas, be different. It was not on that particular Tuesday morning that I learned that some school, perhaps all schools whose brochures will have words like quality, and excellence, and achievement-oriented. You can try to find the schools online, and they would have, many of them would have a website, that these schools, achievement-oriented schools, if you will, encourage children to have ideas. However, I was reminded of how much some of us, a certain portion of us in this country, take this for granted. And I was also reminded, and I thought about how, as a parent of a child in this school, as many parents, a certain portion of parents in the country, perhaps the larger portion of parents in the country, in any case, whatever your family tradition, whatever your religion, your creed, your race, teach, or your culture, things about children having ideas, this idea of having ideas and questions and their own views. Achievement-focused schools, the schools that would have words like quality and excellence in their brochures, on their websites, and universities value students who share their ideas, who speak, who give good presentations, who ask questions. So the beginning of this talk is to say, and could you move to the next slide, Mohammed? So the schools that are unlike what you see here, this is a creche in Tembelihle in Johannesburg. So schools that are not like this, where children struggle to pay 20 rand for pajama day, and there are threats to parents posted on the window. Mohammed, could you go to the next slide, please? So to teach African children to approach what they see, what they hear, what they read, what they learn from others, from television, from Instagram, from newspaper, Snapchat, Instagram, Instagram, WhatsApp, and other social media, even from their teachers, from you as a parent, with a questioning attitude, sets those children up for success. in such an educational system. The opposite is, of course, that if you don't teach your children such an attitude, a critical attitude, an attitude of questioning, that you're setting them up for failure. An interesting bit is my son, ever since I told him that he should resist and never agree to anything without thinking about it, always uses this against me, that I am resisting. You said I must resist. I don't think this is what I want to do. And it can be a difficult but also interesting journey. Traditionally, in our society, in this society, but also many other societies, there have tended to be two groups who are restrained from having ideas, from voicing their opinions and offering their responses in classes, in schools, and at universities. These are female students and African students. Hence, Black female students tend to be, African female students tend to be most restrained in voicing their views in classes. It is particularly when these students lack confidence to express themselves in the medium of instruction, which tends to be mostly English and some Afrikaans in our country, that they tend, that are used in many African universities in our country, that they attend an endless number of classes without ever voicing a word. It is not always the case, but I suspect that there are many students who must find school and university a joyless, terrifyingly joyless experience, not only an oppressive one. I'm also speaking from some residues of experience here. To mutely attend classes, lecture after lecture, or classes, is not only oppressive. You go one semester after another, year in, year out, without finding anything to trigger a contribution from you, a question, an idea, cannot be a great way to pass the time. And we have this in our society, in our schools. So more than our desires then for our children to succeed at school, to get a tertiary education or a good job, to start a business of their own, one of the things I think we don't do well enough in our country is to develop in African children this feeling, this sense, this material sense of freedom and a familiarity with it. Could you move to the next slide, please? This sense then of freedom includes a certain ecstatic skepticism about what they learn at school from their parents, from others, from friends, from the media. If we nurture this, my sense is if we nurture in our students and children to whom we will entrust the future, even today, free, secure, questioning minds, they will be less likely to suspect us of oppressing them. If we were committed to doing so. And only when they are free then to ask questions, to be wrong, to make mistakes, if they are unable to question the traditions and truths that make up their societies, including words like freedom, which I will return to, and also to question science, knowledge, law, history, identities, their own identities, indeed everything, will our children, African children, young people find out what freedom in their lives can mean, means, does not mean, what they can do with that freedom, and therefore be able to give their considered, authentic response to the questions that they will inexorably have to answer. This deliberation, this thinking on freedom, follows from my thinking about what is it that we do as psychologists, particularly as a psychologist on this continent, in this country. African psychology for me is situated practice. It is a practice tied to one's own situatedness. This is an orientation or a set of orientation. It is that knowledge that is very aware, that is always aware of its own location, of its own context, of its own history, of its own birth. So when I talk about African psychology, I'm not talking about a separate body of knowledge out of, if you will, psychology proper. I am specifically, so first of all, I'm talking about a number of orientation, but also I'm thinking about how one situates one's work and oneself in a country such as this, in a continent such as this, in the world in which we live. And I can go on then and say, the idea of a plural enterprise, and I left that as was fading out into the horizon there. This idea of plural orientations, of plural stances, is an attempt to question this idea that African psychology is of one fabric, is of one stance, it is homogeneous. But also, I am also gesturing to the fact that all psychologists are situated. Western psychology, or specifically American psychology, is precisely that. It is American psychology. Next slide, please. In several pieces of work, I have offered a framework for thinking about and doing and seeing African psychology. This idea of African psychology as situated knowledge and practice. The main idea underpinning the framework is simple. It is this, that African psychology is composed of a number of repertoires of multiple orientations towards Africa and psychology. And I have indicated four of this, but increasingly I'm thinking perhaps because I don't make clear that you can have an African psychology of individual differences. Maybe one I should be more explicit that of course African psychology is interested in the individual, even if we contest about how we think about the individual. Mohammed, could you move to the next slide, please? Okay, I will do this myself, I see. Thank you. There are four orientations. They are distinguishable from each other by how, as I said, one situates oneself, also one's work, how one situates oneself in respect to Africa, to psychology, to Africa in psychology, to the world. And what is important for me is to indicate that these four orientations are not definitive. They are heuristics. What matters most is that there are a multiplicity of ways to think about this. But from my reading of the work that appears in journals in Africa, and for South Africa, two particular kinds of journals, which is, or three, if you will, the Journal of Psychology in Africa, South African Journal of Psychology, and Psychology in Society. The people who tend to write in it could be categorized into four orientations. The first one is a Western psychological orientation or Euro-American psychological orientation. The second one is a cultural African psychological orientation. The third one is a critically inclined psychological orientation. The last one, which is a very small body of work, are people who are closer to what you might call what is known, or rather, what is African studies. And some of these people, I have names in my mind, but I can refrain from telling you about them right now. So it is easy to grasp this, what are these, but perhaps the drawing is an attempt, or this graphic is an attempt to say the biggest terrain of psychology in South Africa is taken by Western psychological orientations. In the university where I work now, universities where I have worked, we still tend to follow a certain idea of what psychology is. So whatever course you're doing, and the texts we use, of course, are from the US, and sometimes they're from Europe. So this psychology is what is called mainstream psychology. It doesn't even call itself Western psychology. It is just psychology. The majority of psychologists are located this, including myself, historically, but also it's not a fixed position, right? Sometimes you can work in this position and then you move to other positions, but the majority of us always are located within this. And then those who are more explicit in calling themselves African psychologists, you might have read some of their work. I have in mind here Augustine Noyer and Tlantla Mkiza and several others tend to work from what I call a cultural African psychological orientation. They talk a lot about also spirit, religion, values, worldviews, and philosophical African psychology. And this is what I categorize broadly as cultural African psychological orientations. And you might have also seen some of the debates that we've been having in South Africa. There's then a smaller body of African psychology that insists on material conditions, that insists on power, on politics, speaks a lot about colonialism, on coloniality. This is what I call critical African psychology. But of course, this borders are almost quite close, and I've mentioned a psychological African studies orientation. Now, I wish to return to psychological freedom. A few days ago, last week, as a matter of fact, when I shared the webinar on Instagram, I asked the question, are there ways we might make freedom more real? I asked, is what we were seeing on the week of July 11, a rage against freedom or something that goes under the name freedom? I received a response, among others, from somebody who goes with the handle Kamagwini, who asked, are we really free though? And my response is, that is the question. Freedom, even as apparently straightforward a type as political freedom, is not that simple to grasp. So the question whether since 1994 we have been free is an important question we should exercise ourselves with. But also, you might know that before 1994, there was a portion of this country who were free, at least lived, so white people in this country for a long time lived in some kind of freedom as opposed to black people. So even if we know what we are free from apartheid, free from colonialism, do we know what we are free to do? Does political freedom simply mean the release from colonial oppression, from apartheid, freedom to vote, to stand for office, freely participate politics? Does it always signal and require other types of freedom? I'm reminded a while back about the protests. I think they were in Lebanon, if not in Tunisia. A story, and one of the quotations in that story was of a young man who says, we don't want democracy, we want jobs. And that's precisely what we are experiencing in our country right now. So can we have political freedom when we don't have freedom, for instance, to express ourselves, to drive? I'm taking this idea of to drive because Pumla Dineo Gola, in her new book, goes on to a great deal about women in Saudi Arabia who fought for this and eventually, after a long time, were allowed to drive. But even then, the activists who had protested were still in jail. Some of them might still be in jail. Freedom to associate freely, freedom to dress the way we like. You might remember, again, incidents in Noord, taxi rank in Johannesburg here, a while back. You might remember some incidents in Swaziland as well about women not allowed to wear certain clothes, even in a country that's supposedly free. So can we be free where the media is inhibited? There are some places that are free in the way South Africa was free before 1994. So societies that are supposedly free, but we have to question what kind of freedom is that? There are societies where women could not, cannot drive or walk alone, although the country is called free. There are societies where queer sex is illegal, criticizing the government gets you jailed, posting something on Twitter, on Facebook, make the government, even though the country is called, is liberated or free or independent. Uganda comes into mind, Nigeria more recently. These questions for me, in any case, because I am interested in an African psychology as a politically colored activity. So these questions are important to me. They're important in teaching about emancipation, about freedom, as a psychologist. They are important for me because I want to trace the history of the entrails of African freedom struggles. I'm interested in them because I want to look at the future of freedom, as though I'm some sort of Zangoma, really. But what is around the corner? What is it that we are not seeing? So here, though, in the next 10 minutes or so, perhaps less, I want to limit myself. I want to limit us to considering concrete acts of freedom so that we can make this idea of political freedom apprehensible. What I have in mind is freedom from the overt or subtle coercion to live, to work, to think, to see, to feel in a way that does not privilege white, male, Euro-American gaze. The individual's autonomy to be and to look is a must of political freedom. And we can add all the other things I've already suggested. Freedom of the press goes together with freedom to vote. Freedom to associate goes together with freedom from oppression. So absolutely then, freedom is always beckoning, is always calling for other rights, at least as far as I can see. Now, a few examples. It is well established that white racism, for instance, seeks to turn black people into inferior humans, which means unfree humans. It wants to render them as servants. It criminalizes them. It makes them into children, into infants. Or when it wants to be charitable, it stereotypes them as gullible creatures. The same holds for sexism. Its goal is to turn women into objects, into bodies, into children, childlike beings who look up to men, into help us. And this is a common refrain that, you know, even women who believe in, who support, who subscribe to patriarchy, that they help. The effect in all cases to subordinate. And we can talk then about something that I think underpin what we saw in July 11th, that it is also true of how the rich look upon those who are poor. The poor are lazy, they are looters, they're delinquents, they are pathological, they harbor mental and medical diseases, they're destructive. So part of what you see in how the reports from the media are about a certain way of thinking about poor people. Because precisely this idea of looting is what happens among the rich, but the kind of august attitude, a response is not always visible, at least as far as I can see. Now, to understand how to overcome oppressive systems such as white racism or vampire capitalism or sexist patriarchy, the stereotypes that they convey and their effects, we want to know, I want to know how these systems achieve feelings of inferiorization, but also if you're on the side, on the quote-unquote right side, if you're a man, if you're heterosexual, if you're white, if you are well off, how they achieve feelings of superiority. Let me focus on the subjects who are oppressed. How are they able, the system, to inject, to introject, if you will, for psychologists, feelings of being lesser beings, via which roots? How does this psychical disfiguration become possible? Why, in the targets of the systems, why do I, if I'm living in a place where I'm hungry and I don't have much, do I allow this inferiority, that his hunger itself is a sign that I am inferior? These revulsions, exoticisms, these hates and fetishes, how do they get into our hearts and minds and make us so unfree? So there's a flip side to this, which I hope we can talk about. What are the roots then to Black freedom, to Black self-belief, to Black authority, to Black self-care, to Black love, to Black authenticity in a whitened world? And you can apply this, of course, to the other examples I gave about sexism and vampire capitalism, the exploitative capitalism that we live under. So this was about political freedom, but I've already moved a little bit to psychological freedom. If political freedom is an involved idea, it's such a complex idea, when it comes to psychological freedom, we step into an infinitely complex world of emotions, of affects, of cognitions, of relations. And I go on, I can go on, but I will not go into the detail about how some people have defined freedom. But I can give you just two of this. One is by somebody called Gael Brulin, the Dutch psychologist, I think, Ruud Veenhoven, who says psychological freedom is the capacity to make life choices and the absence of inner restrictions. And then one I like a lot is by somebody all psychology students learn about, Burras Frederick Skinner, who says that freedom is not a state of mind or feeling, that it is a result of the processes of operant conditioning, which is contingent upon consequences referred to as reinforcers. So he's saying basically, we can't do anything but choose the type of control to which we submit. Since we cannot escape control, there's always control. And when you think about capitalism, capitalism controls us by the wage, with wages, with money, with salaries. And so within that control, you can have greater or lesser control. I see psychological freedom then as historically inflected, as dense, as context dependent. But it is also, for me, a founding supposition of African psychology, in the sense that when we're doing African psychology, of course, we're doing it be free of the domination, of the control of the hegemonic form of psychology, which is Euro-American psychology. And I want us to think, and I've been thinking about psychological freedom because it is vital to think about this, because patriarchal sexist oppression, for instance, is not only about laws, laws concerning marriage or rape or reproductive health or equal pay for the same work. It is also located in, if you will, inside us, in our attitudes, in our beliefs, in our practices, who you can cannot marry, under what traditions. And the work I've done here is to think about people who marry, queer marriages, for instance, about the kinds of freedom that is possible. And I'm always struck about the limits of imagining marriage practices. And in this case, the very meaning of marriage. In the myths of, for instance, the discourse of real rape versus that which encourages victims not to make a big deal about what your boyfriend or your husband did. I see psychological freedom or autonomy is about claiming for ourselves the right, as I said, to look, to create, to be wrong, to question, freedom to design the environment under which we live, at least have a voice in the kinds of houses, for instance, in South Africa, built for us. And you will note this, that in our country, for instance, at least from my experience, from my observations and my work, that children of the middle classes, our children, my child, the children of the rich, have more opportunities to fail. So they are allowed to make a lot of mistakes. We don't offer that kind of freedom to poor children. Freedom to ask more questions is another part of this. So, in ending, two things. Psychological freedom means being free to ask uncomfortable questions in the face of the pressure to keep quiet. Not just questions for others, but precisely questions about the things we hold dear. And there are many things we hold dear. And for me, the events of July 11th were precisely about this. The people might have been asking this question, and they do quite a lot in South Africa, in Vuyani, in Venda, you might remember this, about we don't want this. But of course, they are not heard. They are not heard because of their positioning in society. And this is not at all to encourage the kinds of acts we saw. But in reading the newspapers, even this week, so 2 weeks of Sunday newspapers, I saw only once a mention of the word capitalism. It was mentioned in an article by Ibo Mandaza, who is a Zimbabwean, I think was writing in the Sunday Times, I might be wrong. Ibo Mandaza mentions capitalism. So in most newspapers that I was reading since then, the word capitalism is not mentioned, is not explicitly mentioned, particularly that capitalism can tell you that what you have is freedom, even while you are suffering. That is precisely the conditions under which we live. So when we, last word, when we psychologically experience our own humanity as inferior, as less than, when we believe that we are not entitled, when others believe that we are not entitled, and I like this word entitled, because I hear it quite a lot, people says they are too entitled, they act in an entitled way, but most of us, who have some money and some good jobs, we always take this entitlement, this rights as our own. But when you live in Alexander and you're drinking in your yard and the police come, they're basically saying you are not entitled to even a voice. So we are not entitled to be in the world as others are. No law can change our experience and grief. And so this is where psychology, a critical psychology, politically embedded psychology, African psychology, can come into its being to go where the law doesn't go. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Ratele. Can we have Professor Kigua step into the room?
Thanks, Shanaz, and thank you, Kopano. So I've been doing a lot of thinking when I read your book, and I've been doing a lot of thinking as you were speaking now. And I'm trying to think about the best way for me to start this. So I'm obviously going to start with a thank you for the invitation to engage with you today. And to kind of reimagine psychology as well, and to think through this idea of freedom that you've been talking to. For the people who are listening in on us today, I want to start by telling you something about my relationship to Copano that I think will give you some idea about my relationship to his work. And I'm going to start with this book. This is a social psychology textbook, and Copano has a chapter written in this book. I have read a number of his works since my entry into psychology, but I want to speak to the chapter in this book in particular. And the title of this chapter is called A Social Psychology of an Actual Living Society. A Social Psychology of an Actual Living Society. And I'll tell you why this chapter, but just the title itself is one that has always fascinated me. And that's because there's an obvious response to the idea of society, which is that you wouldn't really need to put an adjective to that in terms of a living society. And so that's always struck me when he speaks about a living society. And part of my fascination with that has been in terms of thinking about the possibilities of what that could mean, right? So when we talk about something that is living, the possibility of aliveness, the possibility of something that is real. And that's always fascinated me. At the same time, what's fascinated me is the idea of death, right? If a society is not living, then it can only be dead or in process of dying. And so as much as I've thought about the possibilities of society and thinking about the possibilities of psychology, I have also thought about the kind of impossibilities of society and psychology. And related to that, I have then been thinking a lot about the idea of responsibility. What kinds of responsibilities do we have as people who live in society? But more importantly, what responsibilities do we have as people who call ourselves psychologists and are in the business of healing? So that's where I want to start, because Copano, in many ways, is a colleague, a friend, a scholar who has disturbed me since my entry into psychology. He's disturbed me in a good way. I always like to say that he tends to kick the foundation from right under you, but at the very same time, he catches you. So he's been doing that with me for quite a number of time. And what I want to discuss today with you, Copano, and with everyone listening in, is to think through some of the reflections that you've put forward for us in your book. And to think about this idea of disturbing with the aim of catching, okay? So when I read The World Looks Like This From Here, this is now my second reading, and my sense is that there is at least four entry points for us here, four sites of entry for us. The one is, it's a reflection on the discipline of psychology. The second, it's a reflection on those of us who teach, research, and practice psychology. It is also a reflection on the world that we live in. And lastly, it's a reflection on the multiple worlds that live inside of us. So thinking about these three entry sites into engaging with the book, I want to kind of reflect on this idea of doing African psychology. And in some ways, what the book does is that it starts off with trying to think through this idea of entanglements and the entanglements we find ourselves as psychologists, as people who practice psychology in Africa, but also as Africans who are living in a world that thinks about us and relates to us in very particular ways. And so the book explores African psychology as orientation to think about these problems that are unique to us in terms of our location, but it also tries to think through solutions. And that's what I really like about it. And so while the book engages quite a diverse range of entanglements and solutions, I want to stay with the idea of freedom. And for me, this is a very difficult word for a number of reasons. The one is, part of its difficulty is that it's very hard to try and imagine freedom outside of its abstract meaning. And to try and do that in a way that honors this idea of a social psychology of an actual living society. The other difficulty with the word freedom is that it's very difficult for me to try to think about the possibilities of freedom in the face of so much unfreedom, right? And Kopano, you've spoken to this. So I am with you, Kopano, in the way that you challenge us to trouble our understanding of freedom, the way that you challenge us to question what we understand by psychological well-being. And I think that any psychology that loses sight of people, any conceptualization of freedom that loses sight of people is a problem. And so if we start with the frame that freedom cannot just be about free enterprise in the way that we tend to think about freedom, freedom cannot be only about political freedom. So what are the other kinds of flag points of freedom? And you've alluded to quite a range of this, but I want to add to that. I really like in the book the way you talk about the problem of living well and the problem of dying well as an issue of freedom. What does it mean to live lives that can be considered free? But what does it mean to die well as well? So when we think about young people who die before their time, who die in abject poverty, what does it mean when we talk about the different ways that people die as an instance of their freedom? You also talk about what you call awake to Africa. And you actually speak about that as a way of thinking about a possible solution to the many unfreedoms in Africa. But I also want to add to that and try to think about how we could be attentive to the unfreedoms in Africa as part of this Awake to Africa. We are a continent that is continuously waging war against sexual and gender marginalized populations. We are a continent that is continually waging war against women and children. We are a continent that talks about different various forms of vulnerabilities, but we never really talk about the vulnerabilities of Black men to homicide, especially here in South Africa. So to try and think about these different on freedoms as a way to try to think about being awake to Africa. You also talk about how we are not often taught how to be free. It's something I want to come back to. So this idea that we could have access to education, but what does it mean or what does it matter if we are not taught well, right? If we are not taught how to be free. The Indian economist Amartya Sen tells a story from his childhood. Growing up in 1948, during the 1948 conflict between Hindu and Muslim. And he tells a story of an old man who has fallen at the gate of his house and he has been stabbed and is in the process of dying. And this man has come to this household for help. And on the way to the hospital, on the drive to the hospital, he tells them that as much as he was aware of the conflict that was happening out in the street and the violence that was happening out in the streets, and knowing very well that stepping out of his house could possibly mean the end of his life. And in fact, his wife had begged him to not do that. And he says he had to do that because he needed to find work. He needed to find work so he could have some money to buy food for his family. And Amartya Sen recounts this story as a way for us to start thinking about what he calls comprehensive unfreedom, and thinking about material conditions that make it impossible for us to even die well, to live well. So this was not just a man who was victimized as a Muslim and who died because he's a Muslim, but this is also a man who was unemployed and looking for work so that he could care for his family. And so the different strands of freedom and what that means is something that you flag throughout the book, and one that I think is very insightful for us to think about psychological freedom in relation to political freedom and economic freedom. I'm also interested in the lack of freedom to leave, but also the freedom to love and to be loved, the freedom to be intimate with oneself and with another, and to try and think about these different forms of relating and relation as more than just, you know, the kind of privatized, individual, romanticized way we tend to think about love. I'm interested in trying to think about the freedom to imagine the future via a lens of hope and longing. The freedom to look into the eyes of our children and have a sense that they actually do stand a chance at life and living. The freedom to be wrong that you talk about, the freedom to fail, the freedom to question, the freedom to look, the freedom to choose. And for me, the freedom to speak from a place that centers our experiences and our knowledge as Africans, the freedom to explore what healing could look like from such a location. And for me, the big thing here is the freedom to dream, because if we're going to start envisioning an African psychology and doing an African psychology, the capacity to dream about and to think about what that could look like in practice, not just theory. So having gone through these flag points of freedom, I want to try and think about, because you dared me, Kopano, and so I want to take you up on that, to think about how do we arrive at freedom. And for me, there's five flag points that I want to talk through. There's a whole range, but I'll stick to these five. The one is freedom and diversity versus freedom in diversity. And what I mean by this is this notion of difference. How do we work with difference? Do we want to leave difference alone and allow people to be who they are and do what they want to do and to practice the kind of psychology that they want to practice without any fear of subjugation? Or do we want to engage with a psychology that actively supports people to be different and to practice African psychology, but in ways that allows for a kind of active civil, political, economic participation, so that it is not an African psychology that is tolerated, yeah? An African psychology that is welcomed in conversation and is understood that will be practiced by people on the margins and they can continue to do their thing. So how do we have a conversation about an African psychology that has the opportunities to be included in civil, political, economic participation? That's the one thing. And I think in asking that question, I'm also framing it as a way to, for us to think about the practicalities, yeah? My second flag point is identity. We are in the business of identity. Well, we call ourselves psychologists who are interested in identity. And that means we need to engage with the violence of identity. If we think about all of these unfreedoms that you have spoken to, that I have alluded to, most of it boils down to the violence of identity. We kind of have a sense of the historical roots of this violence of identities, and we can trace that. But what do we want to do with it? What do we want to do with the with the distortions of identity that make it impossible for us to engage with each other without the lens of an epistemic closure. So that we do not feed into the kinds of violence that demands that we erase each other, that we completely obliterate each other's existence. Whether it's talking about the clamping down of a lot of African governments in terms of trans communities, same-sex, gender, queer individuals. This thing about obliterating and erasing the other. How do we want to engage with that kind of violence? And I think the promise of an African psychology is that it allows us to remember that what we are actually about is engaging and working with the multiplicity of identities. And to disrupt this kind of one-dimensional idea of identity that dominant Eurocentric psychology has offered to us. And so to try and think about ways that we remember the way that our identities are connected, ancestral, collective, to think about the idea of rehumanizing a collective understanding of the self and this idea of the human. So that's my other question, but possibly solution as well. And my third flag point here is what you've talked about, love, but not just any love, Black love. And for a moment, I want to not talk about love in terms of its intimate, private formation or the way that it configures, but I want to try and think about public acts of love. And I think that there is something that Black feminist and Afro-feminist politics have always offered us, and I think continue to offer us. And it's this idea of a solidarity that is based on love. So if we actually try to think about the politics of love and what that could mean when we try to imagine, what does it mean to imagine in love and care, to organize in love and care, to lead with care and love. And I think these movements have provided some of the ways that we could start to think about that. I think at some point we got stuck. We either got stuck or we just never moved forward. And so part of what Black feminists and Afro-feminists have offered to us is a way for us to start thinking about what it means to come together via a kind of feeling and politics of love that is not grounded in an identity politics. And that is that would be my envisioning of what a Black feminist politics and an Afro-feminist politics looks like. But I think what these movements have also offered to us is a way for us to not get too stuck on defending. To not get too stuck on safeguarding in so that we forget to do the work of building. And so for me, what that kind of looks like is let's not get stuck on educating and reminding and speaking about the value of African psychology. We also need to get to the, we need to get on with it. We need to get to the nitty-gritty of what it means to build. And what this means is that curriculums must be reimagined. Teaching practice must be reimagined. Ethics committees that tell us what research may or may not, what research may or may not be conducted must be reimagined. What does it mean to do research in Africa and for Africans? Healing practices must be reimagined. What these movements have also offered us is a way to think about organizing for change that is not always about looking to leaders to offer us change, to start thinking about the ways that we can hold our leaders accountable, but to also hold ourselves accountable. And I think this is part of the work that needs to happen now. What Black and Afro-feminisms have also offered us is continuously this refusal to remain or to stick to a kind of rigid boundary between private and public. Because I think this is part of what an African psychology is implicitly challenging as well. To recognize the intimate connections of what it means to be unfree and to be free between the social and the subjective, and how all of this is part of the work of healing. And I think part of that means that we then need to really grapple with inherited hate of blackness. This needs to be addressed head on. And you talk about this in terms of, you know, a kind of self-love. And I think it's part of that. We don't talk enough about the kind of affective politics of apathy that seems to have taken hold of us, that seems to feed this indifference to the presence of Black suffering bodies, to the normalization of Black bodies suffering, to the normalization of violence against Black bodies. And so this inherited hatred of Blackness is something that we're going to need to confront. And my fourth flag point to thinking about question/solution is the necessity for us to attend to intersections. And so for a moment here, I want to trouble freedom. And to trouble a conceptualization of freedom for African people that does not mean freedom for African women, because they're not necessarily the same thing. We can talk about freedom for African people, but that does not always translate into freedom for African women, for African, for sexual and gender marginalized populations in Africa. And so this kind of awareness of what it would mean to trouble a conceptualization of freedom that tends to universalize. And so I want to have this conversation with you, Kopano, because you flagged this. And I'm going to kind of say that you flagged this, but not much African psychology truly engages with gender and sexuality in the way that you do. And so part of my troubling of this universalizing of our lot in Africa is trying to trouble this kind of universalizing of freedom as well. And this brings me to another strand of the work that you have, that you've done throughout your career, which is your work on men and masculinities. I know people tend to separate that when they talk about your trajectory, but I don't separate that. I think your work around African psychology in many ways ties into the work that you've done around men and masculinities. And so for a moment, I wanted to talk about that work as part of engaging with these intersections. As I said earlier, we live on a continent that continually wages war against sexual and gender marginalized populations, against women and children. But we also live in a continent that I'm not sure fully recognizes that Black men are very vulnerable and are at risk of homicide, especially here in South Africa. In fact, statistically, they are the most at risk. So the way that you introduce us to thinking about men and masculinities as part of the work of doing African psychology is a conversation I'm very keen to have with you. Because I think part of what that speaks to is that we need a new tradition for thinking about masculinities, for the way that we theorize about masculinities and toxic patriarchal masculinities, but then thinking about what it means for freedom and what it means for African psychology. So I think this is part of the reimagining that needs to happen. And maybe part of that means that as much as we want to attend to the intersections and we need to honor the intersections, we also just need to be continuously wary about the ways that we don't want to get stuck in a politics of identity, because that's going to take us into a kind of Olympics of who is more oppressed, right? My fifth and last flag point for thinking about question and solution is this idea of letting go of our relationship to knowledge or what we think we know. And I'm going to go out on a limb here and say that I do not think that psychologists fully understand the world. Or I will phrase that differently. I do not think that our current training makes it possible for us to understand the world fully. And so this is not just a failure in psychology. I think it's a failure in terms of education practice more generally, but I'm going to stick to psychology, and which is that we are not trained and we are not taught to understand the world. And why does this matter? It matters because we claim to be in the business of healing. And so the question then is, how can we heal what we do not understand? How can we heal when we haven't been taught and we are consistently taught to not understand? So this is about the way we look and the way that we see. You and I have had a conversation, Copano, about this, but and we've spoken about the ways that, in funny enough, we tend to go outside of psychology, you and I, so that we are able to see. And this is very ironic. So I can't tell you the number of times that I have turned to disciplines outside of psychology, disciplines that have helped me to question the world that I live in, that have helped me to better understand complexities of identity. Disciplines of literature, disciplines, the artistic and creative disciplines that have helped me to do all of that. And so we need to talk about this other kind of unfreedom, the unfreedom of disciplinary gatekeepers, because this is what part of the problem is in psychology. So to conclude, I want to say this. I have a very uneasy relationship with disciplines. And so I have for a very long time thought of African psychology as a discipline. And so I must confess that I've had a very uneasy relationship to African psychology in the same way that I've had an uneasy relationship to the discipline of psychology more broadly. But what you do in this book is that you flat out say this is not a discipline. And in fact, you refuse African psychology as a discipline. Instead, you invite us to think about it as an orientation. And I quite like that idea. And I want to have further conversations with you about that, because I think that distinction is very important. And if you could tell us something about why you make that distinction. Throughout the book, you talk about the book as not only a book, you refer to it as an exercise. You refer to it as a call, and you refer to it as an invitation. And reading the book again, this is what it felt like, an invitation. And you also tell us right at the end of the book that it's not an easy thing that you are asking us to do. I agree with you for three reasons. One, I think there are some of us who do not think that there is anything problematic about the current practice of psychology in Africa. There are some of us who think that there is a problem, but we have no idea where to begin. And there are some of us who are a little bit worried about the inevitable disorientation that is bound to arise, because this is what happens when your comfort zone gets ripped out right from under you. And so to those people who feel worry, I want to say that Copano will rip the rug from right under you, but he will also catch you. And I will leave it here and open up for a conversation with you, Copano, and maybe a conversation with everyone else. Thank you.
Shanaz, or size of people, would you like me and Peace to invite people to comment or to step up? How are we going to do this?
Hi, Prof. They can comment in the chat.
Okay. All right. But we'll take some of those. Very briefly before I get to some of them, peace. Thank you so much. And you're quite right. I mean, those three words I use: an invitation, a call. Somewhere I think I said a manifesto as well. I do that, and particularly about this idea: why not as discipline? Precisely. Well, the one reason is what you have just offered. There is a term called disciplinary decadence. You might know by Gordon Lewis, Lewis Gordon. Basically, when the discipline itself is its own confirmation, basically that we owe fidelity or to models. I mean, psychologists, we do this, so we are psychoanalysts. We can get out of it, or we are Rogerian, person-centered psychology. So that is the truth. You can't get out of that. And so similarly, I have been discussing lately about a social psychology book, for instance. I might have vanished. I'm not sure where I am.
I see you.
I'm sorry if you can't see me. I can't see myself here on the screen. In any event, we have been having with a colleague of mine, a close colleague, precisely that when you write a social psychology textbook, you're supposed to follow certain topics. You can't get out of those topics. It's a first year psychology textbook looks almost the same. All psychology textbooks, you start with biology, for instance, the research method, sometimes biology, and then you go to perception, you go to, and you know all the topics. Why is poverty not a psychological topic? Right up there for a society such as ours. Why is that not a topic? Why violence, which tends to feature mostly social psychology as aggression, future right towards the end rather than at the beginning because it's a huge thing. Why is inequality not part of it? So you start to see that the discipline itself tells you that if you're going to study other problems that we have, that don't have a history in psychology, that are not part of the canon, you are not doing psychology. And I refuse that. That's really one reason why I left psychology for over nearly a decade and a half. The orientation basically says this is how things, you are focused on the problem and you are orienting yourself towards the problem, towards the person here sitting in the therapy room, towards the student, the knowledge that they bring in the lecture room, towards the world. And I give examples about traveling. That people would say, you know, I was in New York or wherever, and then and everything changed for me. I'm thinking, well, you don't have to really travel like that physically, which many of us here probably have done. To start to rethink the rethinking you're talking about, that you have to orientate yourself, imagine the world as it could be, to recreate, to create another world. This is particularly what, for me, critical psychology, what I call a critical psychology, is a creative project. It's a beautiful insurrection. You're saying, no, psychology can be different. And critical psychology is not, in my head, something that sits in the corner of psychology. It should be in therapy. You should thinking beyond what is called the frame, but it's precisely what you say, this control of gatekeeping, the gatekeepers, the scope of practice. But of course, it's about guild, right? That you are trained like this and you follow that. And if the training itself is already off, if the training that you receive is already misleading, miseducating you, clearly you're going to pursue that, and very few of us ever get out of this. But I see in some quarters in South Africa, in vets, at UCT, at Stellenbosch. So there are people at UKZN who are doing this unruliness, this insurrection. This is not working, and this is an important thing to surface. Peace. There's such a lot of things, but maybe one last thing. And I was asking you this because I have been struggling in myself, but I'm getting closer and closer to bringing the psychology of boys and men and masculinity to much closer to my thinking of this broad African psychology. And I can see, and precisely the idea is in orienting yourself to men. What do I mean by this? I mean, you have already touched on it. There's a book by a woman called Chandra Gould. It's a report book slash report. It tells the story of men who have committed violent crimes and they've been sentenced to long jail terms. And you have to read this. And I can take exactly the same examples and then transfer them to what's been happening in Phoenix the events of July 11. So when I'm reading Chandra Gould, every time I reread this book, I'm thinking, it's like the moment you start to read this, you say, how can this man ever escape this? I mean, they drop out of school, they join gangs at an early age, at 11, at 10, perhaps they are raped or they're sexually violated in other ways. Their parents are negligent, they're neglected. And so the concatenation of events, of life circumstances, lead them. So they're abused repeatedly before they start committing violent crimes themselves. So to read this person from close up, to do their life histories, as it were, you start to realize about, for one thing, about how much you can't think only of the direct violence of men without thinking of the kinds of direct and structural violence under which they grow. And this is the difficulty we have as a society. It's difficult for one reason. For instance, if I watch TV every September, now we do it much more repeatedly. Pelikala comes in and tells you about who died when, you know, and the president. This is a sensitive point. My friends, if my friends are on this webinar, I know I have been getting a lot of clap back. They have been so angry because they say I talk out of 10 and I, these are my friends, these are my colleagues, including Peace, like Pomla, Fulretta Bunzai, my own partner, who just like, this is bad. I'm saying, well, you know, you can't solve the problem of violence against women without solving the problems of violence against men. You can't. It's impossible to say, stop violating other men, stop violating women, but it's okay to violate men. So that's the tension we live in. So you see it when Ramaphosa speak. Listen to him carefully. The violence against men is not mentioned because I don't know, we're locked in this. So you have to stay close to men, to orientate yourself to their lives, to understand them fully in both their violence that they do, but also the violence that is done to them. I think if you see the questions, Peace, can you take
I don't. I'm right on my phone, so I don't see the chat.
There are not many questions, really. And this is Buisi Lemkina says, thank you. This is a rich vessel of knowledge. So I'm not seeing a lot of questions, but Anele asks, or rather comments, that I love the notion of a sense of freedom for an African child. How do we cultivate the view of culture, one that is relatable and accessible to them? Do you want to take that? How do we cultivate the view of culture, one that is relatable and accessible to African children in this, alongside this notion of a sense of freedom for African children? And then can I give you, Marius Absalom says, I have lost my sense of freedom. I am looking for it and hopefully I will find it again. If you could offer a comment about losing a sense of freedom. And then Petra Abraham says, how do we change so that our children can experience the freedom that we are talking about here? So three questions about culture, that we cultivate culture that's relatable and accessible. Marius's question about, well, it's not a question, it's a comment about losing a sense of freedom. I'm not quite sure about how one would respond to that, but perhaps you want to try that. And then lastly, Petra Abraham says, how do we change so that our children can experience the freedom that we're talking about?
Okay, I'll give it a shot. I think Anele is flagging this idea of cultivating a sense of culture that is relatable and accessible. I think what Anele is flagging is, in some ways, different entry points. An entry point of teaching, an entry point of research, and an entry point of the practice of healing, right? So I think part of the reason why the majority of psychologists do not practice a psychology that really works from a space of our experiences and knowledge is because that is simply not taught. And so, like I said earlier, we need to do the work of changing curriculum, the way we teach, what we teach. Otherwise, students in psychology will always graduate from psychology without a sense of relating to psychology. And I think we need to think about those different entry points. So the way we teach psychology needs to radically change. The way we conduct research in psychology needs to radically change as well. And the way we think about what healing could look like and what healing means, that needs a complete overhaul. So, I think this cultivation is at multiple levels. And I'm not sure that these are levels that are easy enough to just switch on. And so we kind of need to do that kind of work. What does it mean to imagine an African psychology beyond just imagination? But what would it look like in terms of practice? And I think that's the work that needs to happen at these different levels.
I might add then, fellow psychologists and psychology students, I'm not sure how what's happening with the technology, but I am not to be held responsible for all of that. Well, it starts with this idea of culture, and I see it particularly with people who are not ethnically African, if you will, so who are not Zulu, Xhosa, Mapedi, or Botswana, or Baswati, including the people I taught for a long time. I used to hear it from students at the University of the Western Cape that colored people don't have a culture. They would say this thing, mm-hmm. And I would be aghast about that because they have a particular kind. They have a particular kind of understanding of culture, and I think they're confusing. The confusion is of course with another word, tradition, which also doesn't mean people who are categorized as colored under apartheid don't have a culture because they have a long history. I mean, in South Africa, probably a great percentage of people who are called colored have a longer history in Southern Africa. So the people who come from that line of the Khoi and the San. They have a long history. I don't get it. It's because they don't have accessed that history. But one can go on. But that's so. The first idea is culture as this thing static, for instance, Amaxhosa, you know, Usiko, and the Ulwaloko and all of that, or Basotho, the Bolo, or how people get married, Upahlela, and so all kinds of rituals, really customs, are confused with the idea of culture. Culture is how we make our life together. It's as simple as that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The making of life together is what culture makes. So culture is a dynamic thing. And this is really important that we are, The moment I go to a restaurant to eat, people don't, as a, an example I give is, people don't go to restaurants, to good restaurants, to eat. They go to make culture. Food that costs 1,000 rand at the test kitchen. That's a ridiculous. Well, forget the ridiculousness of the price. But the idea is you're creating culture, the culture of eating out, a conversation with friends, and so on. So culture is the life we make with each other. Tradition is that life in historical context, in a longer view. So tradition is what is handed down then to us from a previous generation. So to Annelies's question then, that's one view of culture. And Annelies's images that I know about are an attempt already to make this this idea of relatability, of making culture, that kind of culture understood as a thing that's, you know, like as a ritual, basically, as a custom. But as I said, the moment you think of culture in the way a person called, for people who are not familiar with the name, like Stuart Hall at a center at Birmingham a long time ago, and I read him repeatedly. But you know, this it's all over the place if you are looking for it. Culture is films. Culture is television. Culture is art. This is the most relatable thing. The graphics that you see on Instagram, the people making clothes. Today I'm wearing polo neck, which is a particular kind of clothing, but I am astounded at the kinds of freedom of making clothes from Omakosa, for instance, beautiful clothes. The one magazine I subscribe to is VC. VC is a beautiful magazine, South African magazine. I do it because I want to see culture. Now, and one of the things that we fail tremendously that psychologists should interact with is precisely that a minister of culture in South Africa is such a bad minister, because I don't think they quite grasp the importance of culture and what it can do when you inject into it conviviality. That culture is what people do, and you see it under COVID, that because we are separated from each other, some cultural activities come to a stop. So that's the answer to about how it's such a relatable thing, basically, that you don't have to look too far if you understand culture as a in a much wider perspective. Mm. Peace, we have about 7 minutes. You want to take that question, the other two comments?
Just a comment to you, Kopano. You've been asked to turn your camera on, and I think I need to do that on my side as well.
I have turned it on again. I can't see myself, but maybe people see me. I can't.
I can't see myself either, but I'll keep talking. So I think the other question was about losing a sense of freedom and yes, how to get it back.
Right.
It's a difficult question to answer, because it could mean a whole range of things. Freedom could mean a whole range of things. So I'm not quite sure if the question is coming from a personal space, or speaking more publicly. Yes. But what I will say is that, and I think you do flag this as well, is we don't talk enough about capitalism. And I think part of that for me is that we don't talk enough about how depression is intrinsic to this economic, political system that we seem to insist on. And so when we talk about losing a sense of freedom, I don't think that is a uniquely individual struggle. I think many of us struggle with this, and it is inevitable. And I think it's a symptom of just how problematic the system is. How do we get it back? We need to change the system. We need to not be okay that there are people who are living well and dying well, and there is a majority of a population who are not living well and who are not dying well. So we need to change that. We need to change the way we relate to each other. We need to change the way we think about love and hope and connection. It's a lot of things, but I think all of this is part of us trying to grapple with what it means to live in the kind of economic, political, social system that we live in at the moment.
Can I step in?
Yeah.
Because I'm elaborating on you, and I'm glad you mentioned this now for the second time. Peace. And the camera just keeps on turning off. I'm sorry, folk. I have no idea. This system is not working very well.
Same here.
A few days ago, I had said this, and I'm going to repeat it to you if you don't mind. I had said that I like many people in our country, I had some days where I would go when I was young. I was hungry between 11 and about 20. I even ate out of garbages behind Lambton Checkers. It was called Lambton. Lambton is some kilometers outside of Germiston in the east of Johannesburg, East Rand. I would be so desperate with an uncle of mine who was just about my age. We would go and scrounge for food right there. But people said, so I was making a certain point that when I was looking at people just looting for food, but also looking for other goods because they might sell them and hoard, so hoarding them and make money, and that I would be part of them. That I'm not doing this because I have enough food in my house. But people responded to that it was brave. And I think, I didn't think about it in those terms, but I know there was a moment a long time ago in my life where I was afraid to say that, of course, I grew up poor. It's not a bigger story in my life right now for a long time, but that's it. But now I wanted to clarify that this was not about me. Of course, I mean, I mentioned my life, but the point I was making was it was less about myself and more about the millions or people who go hungry in South Africa. Millions, I mean, literally, it's just incredible that we have so many people going hungry. But what I wanted to say then in the second post when I was trying to build on this is that although I have been quote unquote fortunate, I have been fortunate because I, you know, like you, Peace, like a lot of psychologists who are here, you put in a lot of work, you do the assignments, you get to be a psychologist, you get to be a professor, you earn decent amount of money, you can live well. Actually, most professors live very well in South Africa, far better than I think they're overpaid, but that's a different thing. But I have also, this is the point, that I have been lucky enough to realize, and it took me a long time, and I think this is the psychological part, that I had people who loved me when I was not, when I didn't have enough money, and they showed me care, and I experienced what is to be truly cared for, and that has been part of how I freed myself from this idea that being poor is being inferior. I mean, poor is a bad thing in itself, when what is bad is capitalism that makes the brightest minds in our country not achieve what they can achieve, and it is the condition of our freedom. When people say this is not us, except this is us. This is the kind of society we live in. And psychologists, sometimes we do this. We take our people, and which is the work we do, because they are feeling, they're suffering. So you heal that part. But what you forget is how the society is making us sick. And this is where I'm going to stop by saying that I see part of my work as a teacher, of course, and as a psychologist, as an activist, as a scholar activist, to contribute writing, but also talking about how we can make both think about this quite clearly, that of course the problem is the kind of society, this living society, that the society we thought we were getting is not what we have right now, because I believe freedom is such an important thing. We have to strive to make it more real. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Peace. I think we are...
we're right at the end. Yeah.
Shall we wait for the people to switch us off as PsySSA? And thank you everybody for attending.
Thank you everybody.
Fatima, can you hear me?
Prof, we can hear you.
Yes, all right. Can we spotlight our two professors, please? Can we do that?
Yes.
If we're having problems with the technology, it's all right. But I guess I want to say that this evening's engagement has been truly everything that I'd imagined it to be, and much more, just so much more. I thank you, Professors Ratele and Kigua. Thank you so much. I have to tell you that this engagement has left me with a sense of exhilaration that I don't consistently feel in matters of psychology and certainly in matters of freedom. I feel terribly excited. I feel so excited that I almost want to sing the song that you shared with us, Kapano, but I will save you all from the singing voice.
I think you can have it when you walk out of there.
You have both raised thought-shifting questions and possibilities about all kinds of matters, but really, essentially, on issues that stretch our thinking about the politics of freedom and the regimes of freedom. And I loved the way in which you have deeply troubled psychology in exactly the way that we were wanting, anticipating, imagining. And as I keep saying more, I think what this engagement has been certainly for me, but I think the audience too, I'm quite certain of this, is a very powerful and a very profound offering. What we can see is clearly the leading work, the cutting edge work that is being done by comrades and colleagues mm-hmm. in this country, on this continent, that is defining of psychology well beyond the continent. And if I'm waxing lyrical, I mean every word of mm-hmm. it. I feel truly excited this evening, and the questions that you are raising and what you're profiling in terms of African psychologies is especially important, I think, in privileging the work that is being done in African psychologies, very, very much mapping the way forward, but at the same time, alongside that, pointing out what very much still needs to be done. What you're both saying about reimagining, about organizing for change, even as we trouble, is obviously really important. You have set the scene. You have very much set the scene for the webinars that are going to follow. I want to say that you're both urging us to reimagine more than we have been doing. You are urging us to, I think you said the freedom to dream and to get on with it. So certainly, let's get on with it. Let's get on with it. I want to share with you some lyrics from the song. I tried to do that earlier, but I think our connection dropped. And I'm using some creative license here. Give me a minute, please. Yes, when a baby first breathes, when night sees sunrise, when the whale hunts in the sea, when we recognize freedom, 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 breathe in. It's in every living thing, mind. Use your power. Spirit, use your wings. Freedom, freedom, freedom. So I think I should stop talking. Really the resonance needs to stay with our two speakers. Thank you again. Thank you so very much. I said earlier that you've set the scene for the webinars that are to follow, so I want to take a minute to share information on our forthcoming engagements. The next one is on the 26th of August, led by Professors Garth Stevens, President of PsySSA, together with Professor Son, and invited speakers are Professor Baker, Professor Puleng Sehalo, Professor Nelson Maldonado Torres, Professor Omitapa Datta, Decolonial Praxis in Contemporary Global Psychologies. Some of what you heard today in terms of the troublings, one of my friends who's on this webinar talks about the troublings series. So yes, the troubling series will see more troublings happen on the 26th, and then on the 22nd of September, we have Professor Lara Shihai talking to us about psychoanalysis, psychoanalytic innocence, she has titled her talk, The Ideological Underpinnings of Theory and Praxis. We invite you to join us on the 22nd and then of September, and then finally on the 20th of October, Decolonial Enactments in Community Psychology, led by Professor Shose Kesi. So an exciting lineup. We hope you will join us. Thank you again to our audience. Thank you for staying with us. Thank you to the PsySSA office for all the support. Thank you to Professor Garth Stevens, who is in the background today, but who really has been quite central in the organizing of this webinar series. And again, a very, very special thanks to Professors Ratele and Kigua. And we will say goodbye and play out with a little more of the song, right, Fatima? You're going to put that on for us? Thank you.
Thank you, Shanaz. Thank you, Peace. Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, everybody.
They know your first name is free, last name is dumb, but you still believe in where we're from.